Hello, everybody. Shall we get started? I think we are all ready to go. And welcome to Global Azure Virtual 2020. What a year this is turning to be. And I've been collaborating with Global Azure for several years now as a speaker and organizers of this event. This year, my collaboration is with our dear Azure friends. So thank you both for the opportunity to be here and share some experience with you guys. My name is Stefano Tempesta, and as you can see from all the pictures on screen, I'm a Microsoft Regional Director. I'm based in Melbourne, in Australia. It is 10 p.m. for me now, so not too bad. Happy to be here. And I'm a Microsoft MVP on Azure as well. And today we talk about design patterns for distributed systems. And I couldn't put more into the slide, but pretty much we focus on Azure Kubernetes Services, or AKS. Now, we're talking about containers, right? So containers and container orchestrators have fundamentally changed the way we look at distributed systems. When in the past, you know, as a developer, you probably have built a system that you built from scratch, resulting in each architecture to be sort of unique and not repeatable. Now we have infrastructure and interface elements for designing and deploying services and applications on a distributed system, using reusable patterns. Sometimes we call them microservice architectures. In general, we want to talk as a containerized component. So this is our focus for today. Today, where there is a strong emphasis on having always own applications and API as well. Availability and reliability requirements that otherwise in the past, will be only available for a sort of a mission critical services. Now we can afford to do that, and also very economically. Now, the potential for rapid sort of viral growth of these services means that every application that we're now building sort of can scale nearly instantly in response to user demand. Sorry, I'm checking a few questions. I didn't mention at the beginning. If anybody has any question, feel free to chat in here, to write in the chat, and I'll be happy to take questions as we go. So, where I was? I was at, there are this requirement for being always on, always ready to go, basically. And these containerized blocks are the basis for development of reusable components. So today, these design patterns that I want to share with you are coming from my experiences of some best practices that you find in documentation around Kubernetes, around AKS. They all dramatically simplify and make accessible the build of this microservice architecture or containerized component. And you can easily achieve reliability, scalability, separation of concerns, and everything that you will want to have in a modern application that, again, is always on and is distributed, is always available. All right, so let me get started. Some basic introduction. I probably should skip this because I assume everybody's familiar by now, but I just want to set the ground just in case someone is really new to this conversation and never heard talking about containers and microservices before. So just very briefly, now the term microservices sometimes abused as sort of a buzzword for describing multi-node distributed software architecture. But in general, microservices describe a system built out of many different components. running in different processes and communicating with each other, often using some APIs. And microservices stand in contrast to a monolithic system, a monolithic application, as the one that you can see in the picture on screen, which tended to place all of the functionality for a service within a single tightly coordinated application. Think of a CRM application, an ERP application, those sort of server application that have a big fat structure where all the functions are all sitting together. Instead, how can we depict this in a microservice-oriented architecture? Now, this picture, I'll try to simplify again, but the picked illustrate how individual functions can be separated on isolated services and interact with each other through a programming interface, through an API. Now, there are uncountable benefits, and this is not a session about the benefit of microservices. This is a focus on AKS, but just let me mention, the benefit of microservices approach are centered around reliability, agility, single responsibility. Microservices in general break down a big application into small pieces, and each piece is focused on providing a single service. So they do one thing, but they do it the best way possible. And this reduced scope enables each service to be built and maintained by a single team as well in a very agile way. So a reduced team size also reduces the overhead associated with keeping a team focused and moving into one direction. So there are technical benefits and also a benefit from a methodology perspective. And in the context of introducing an API, a programming interface between the different microservices, decouples also the teams from one another and provide a reliable contract between the different services, even if or when services are offered by different vendors. So this formal contract reduces the need for a sort of a tight synchronization among the teams, because each team provides an API and then the other one basically has to interface with the API, and that's all they need to know about. And again, this decoupling, it applies at team level, so during the development, but also at the deployment level, so when a service is running and is completely independent. Okay, so now, I want to put this in the context of AKS, but I want to do it in a gradual way. I want to stress the importance that the decoupling of microservices enable better scaling. Each component is broken into its own service. It can scale independently. It offers opportunity for cost savings. I remember one of my past organizations that I work for, we had a very large system, typical monolithic application. We started breaking down into microservices and we noticed cost savings also from an infrastructure perspective when scaling the application. Rather than scaling, adding horizontally or vertically resources like virtual machines or CPU memory for supporting the entire CRM system as it was, we instead could scale only those services that were demanded the most and caused more loaded on the system without scaling the entire infrastructure. So much agility in there. And look, this is very common if you work in a very large organization where each service or functionality doesn't grow at the same rate as the rest of the application. So you want to scale only that single service. All right, so let's go through a few basic terminologies around the AKS. So again, if not everybody's familiar with the Azure services, there are some terminologies in here that are specific to Kubernetes, some that are specific to Azure, Kubernetes obviously is a platform of reference now for managing containers and not just containers, also the associated networking, storage components. And the focus is now on building applications, focusing on making these services available in an infrastructure that is completely managed on Azure without us spending too much time on managing these infrastructure components. And Kubernetes provides exactly that sort of declarative approach to deployment. We'll see a few examples in a few slides, and also source code presented is also shared on GitHub. So it's an open platform. Kubernetes allows you to build application with any programming language you choose, typically on a Linux operating system, any libraries, and completely integrated into your DevOps CI/CD chain tools. Specifically, and Kubernetes, again, you know, is an open source initiative. Specifically in Azure, what Microsoft did is take the Kubernetes service, they reduce the complexity for deployment and for management in general, and they provide it as a service in your Azure portal with the possibility to deploy a cluster, to auto-scale it, to attach storage, to build a stateful and stateless service, and a lot of other things. So let's see how this happens and what are the components that represent the AKS service. And some you see already here on screen. Some basic components of Kubernetes cluster architecture that you should get familiar before describing any of the design patterns that I want to present are two types. You know, one is the cluster master node that provides the core Kubernetes services, the orchestration of application workload, and then the nodes that actually run the application workloads. So if you want to run your application and all the services around the application, including API, storages, you need a Kubernetes node, as simple as that. And an AKS cluster has one or more nodes, which in a Azure virtual machine that runs the Kubernetes node components, you have also all the different elements that you see here on screen. So you see that you have a kubelet, you have a runtime environment, you have a proxy, and the container itself. So the kubelet is sort of the agent that processes the orchestration requests from the cluster master and the scheduling for running all the requested containers. Virtual networking instead is handled by the proxy on each node, and this proxy sort of routes network traffic and manage IP addresses for services and pods. We're going to talk about pod later. And the container runtime is the component that allows the application that run in a container to run and interact with additional resources, including networking and including storage. Okay, so this is sort of a foundation, the context. Let's go now into more specific patterns, how you want to build nice AKS cluster that support a microservice architecture. And the one that you see on screen, a load balance service pattern, is probably one of the simplest distributed patterns, but still one of the most familiar, even when considering a replicated load balance application. So in such an application, as you can see with a user request going through a load balancer, every service is identical. And they all capable of supporting the same type of traffic. And this pattern basically consists of a number of services that all scale independently with a load balancer in front of them. And this balancer can implement any of the balancing strategy, whether it is a round robin or any other form of session stickiness. And now, stateless services are one that don't requires obviously a state to be saved to operate correctly. And in the simplest stateless applications, even individual requests may be routed to separate instances of the service. So that is sort of a preferred approach. You know, when you're running stateless systems, they are replicated on each service to provide redundancy and scale. And to create a replicated service in AKS, you can use an AKS virtual node to provision pods that start in a few seconds. So it's very fast to deploy. And with virtual nodes, you have a fast provisioning of pods. You only pay per the execution time by the second. So you pay per second, basically. And when you want to scale this, you don't need to wait for the Kubernetes cluster to deploy a virtual machine to run all the additional pods. A Kubernetes pod is this group of containers that are already deployed together on the same host. And if you frequently deploy single containers, you can generally replace, you can generally consider a pod equivalent of a container in some way, and have a predefined, a pre-deployed set of pods that are ready to be used when scaling the application. Now, let's see how we can do that. Just with a few samples here, you can, obviously manually scale an AKS cluster. Using the through the Azure portal, you can add run a different number of nodes. You can also scale down. Now, obviously, be careful when scaling down because if resources are still used in a specific node, you may have obviously you need to know to drain these resources to minimize disruption on your running application. To scale the cluster node, you have to execute the command that you see on screen. First, get the name of your node pool using the az aks show command. So this will give you the name of your pool. And after that, here we go, it wasn't coming up. Then use the aks scale command to scale the cluster node. So the following command scales a cluster that I named my cluster to a single node. Then you provide your own pool name from that you got from the previous command from the AKS show. And in this way, you can scale a cluster to increase or decrease the number of nodes. We'll talk in a moment about autoscaler. Autoscaler automatically scales your cluster. Autoscaler particularly watch for pods in your cluster that cannot be scheduled because of some resources constraints. And when issues are detected, the number of nodes is increased to meet the application demand. So this is quite important to understand. And nodes are also regularly checked for a lack of sort of running pods or with the number of nodes, then they are decreased as needed. And but this ability, to automatically scale up or down the nodes in your cluster will get that efficiency and cost effectiveness of your cluster at the end. So, autoscaler Here we go. That's the command. Autoscaler, you need an extension from to the CLI, basically that is, I believe at least 0.4 if I remember correctly, but I can get back on you later with some more references. You need to install the preview extension and then run the extension update, the command to check that there are any other updates available. Consider this is a sort of a preview, so it will get new updates very regularly. In general, as a good practice, it's worth be cautious on some preview features before they are ready in production. And you want to use a separate subscription to test these preview features before actually enabling and actually using in your system. And scaling a container, apply, as we said, to increase or decrease workload, but also you can respond to a schedule demand for load of an application. So, for example, you may want to adjust your cluster between work days and evenings or weekends just to save on some operating cluster operating cost. In this case, the two options that you can use in an AKS cluster are again around the cluster autoscale or the pod autoscaler. So let me get into that in a moment. Here we go. And there's a bit of lag from when I talk to when the slide show on screen. So this is why I have a moment of hesitation. But now I can see that it's showing. So all good. Let's carry on. So the cluster autoscaler watches for pods that cannot be scheduled on nodes because of resource constraints, and then automatically increase the number of nodes. And the sort of horizontal pod autoscaler use metrics that are measured in a Kubernetes cluster to monitor the resource demand of these pods. And if a service needs more resources, the number of pods is automatically increased to meet this demand. So here we go. What else to say? Now, both the sort of horizontal pod autoscaler and the cluster autoscaler can also decrease the number of pods and nodes. The autoscaler for the cluster, they actually decrease the number of nodes when there is unused capacity for a period of time as well. So if now they realize that that node has not been used, then it can also remove it from the cluster. All right, so scaling and balancing is probably a sort of a common practice in some way, and one of the big advantages in using the agility of containers. Have you ever heard about shared services? And this is from the screen, from the picture, seems very similar to the previous pattern, not with a pure balancing of services. But there is a different flavor here. Now, replicating stateless services, we said improve reliability, redundancy, scaling. And within a replicated service, each copy is entirely homogeneous, capable of serving every request. And that was not the patterns that is typically implemented with a load balancer in front. There is a variation of it, which is these shared services and other descent patterns, not in really in contrast, But it's a different flavor. When you assure the service, each copy, which is a shard, is only capable of serving a subset of the request. So the load balancing node, so the balancer, is responsible for examining each request, understand what the request is about, and distributing each request to the appropriate shard for processing. Request number one can be serviced by service one. Number two is of the special type, so it goes to number two. Whereas in the previous case, any request will be a sort of dispatched to the next service available with whatever balancing strategy you use. Sticky session, maybe not, round robin, smart round robin based on actual balance, actual yes, balance, actual utilization, or so on. Sharded is different. Replicated services are not generally used for building stateless services. Instead, sharded services are generally used for building stateful services. And now, the primary reason for sharding for this pattern is that you want to shard the data. That's the main reason. This is why the stateful service. Typically, because the size of this data is too large to be served by a single service, by a single machine. And by sharding, you enable your service to scale in response to the size of the state that needs to be served. What kind of application can benefit from this? Any application that works with incredible large amount of data that can be operated in parallel. Application that you want to run on AKS and they need a very large storage and at this storage, and we'll talk about storage also later, is also sort of a temporary, not available only for the duration of the processing. This specific request. If you instead are after some persistent storage, we'll talk in a moment, that will rely on additional services provided by the Azure platform. But the point here is that you want to understand when you have a need for sharding your services, and this is mainly driven by a request for having a service specialized in processing as a very specific type of data. And again, when this data is especially in large size that cannot be processed by one service only. Now, in terms of storage, I mentioned typically these microservices, stateless, don't have a persistent storage. But with AKS, running Kubernetes in Azure, you can actually attach storage. So you can have some persistent storage. Now, although the good practice to reduce management overhead and in order to scale easily is not to create and assign a persistent volume from a persistent storage, because this will limit your ability to scale in some way. The recommendation is to use a dynamic storage that can be provisioned not with as demanded. The way this happens in Azure, here we go. You can see the slides coming through. The way this happens in Azure is basically by a volume claim. So the picture that you see on screen now refers to a persistent volume claim, PVC, that will let you dynamically create storage as needed. The underlying disk or blob that Azure provision are created as pod request them. And in the pod definition, you request a volume to be created and attached to a design path, basically. Let me show you a few of these in practice, so how that looks like with a few examples here. So to define different tiers of storage, you can have a premium, standard. First, you create a storage class. And the storage class also defines the claim policy that I mentioned is necessary to create to attach a volume dynamically. So this claim policy controls the behavior of the underlying storage in Azure when the pod is mounted or when it's deleted. And the persistent volume then is attached as required. Now, in this case, this simple YAML that you see on screen is show an example using a premium managed disk and specify that the underlying Azure disk should be retained when the pod is deleted. So you see the reclaim policy is retained. So if the pod is removed, then I'm keeping the storage. So this is a case of persistent storage. Whether you're doing if you're doing the shard approach, and you're scaling your system, if you scale down and you remove a service, but you want to retain, then you want to retain your data, the process data, you can retain by having a reclaim policy set to retain. Now, you can create a persistent volume with the apply command, kubectl command, and specify the parameters that you can see in that we have defined the YAML file before. So assume that we save that YAML file as Azure-Premium, then it will create your Azure managed disk. And a persistent volume represent storage that has been provisioned for use by Kubernetes, by the pod specifically. This storage can be used by one or many pods, can be provisioned dynamically, as mentioned, and there are different types. The one that you see here by running the get command, then is an Azure disk. And we'll tell you also how long, what is the age, how long has been provisioned this storage. But there are other type of storage that can be provisioned. You can have file storage. Decent performance, running Linux and Windows. And this is typically used when you want to share data, specifically in the form of file, digital asset, across multiple pods. Not particularly expensive unless it really grows into big size. If you're after great performance and throughput, then you go for a disk, which is the case that we have seen before. So that YAML example was for provisioning an Azure disk. Great performance, higher cost, running Linux and Windows, you will use it for any kind of data, typically application data that you want to persist or that you want to use at runtime. And if you have some static files or something that doesn't have a frequent access or for which you don't need frequent access and frequent elaboration, then they go for a blob storage. Lower performance, lower cost, running on Linux, but perfect for persisting data over a longer term. All right. Any questions around this? Let me double check so I can check the chat. No questions specifically to that. There is a question around the recording. Yes, all the sessions are recorded, so they will be published on the YouTube channel. So stay tuned because, and obviously you will have access to the slide and source code later. All right. The last pattern that I want to present today, or I mean, there are several patterns. There are a lot that can be implemented, but this is my experience mainly around what I do with containerized application in Azure. And I do a lot of, actually, I find myself doing a lot of this scatter-gather pattern. So far, I have examined, no, I have a sort of discussed the system that replicate for scalability in terms of the number of requests that are processed and the load balancer pattern with typically stateless approach, stateless services, and then also the scalability in terms of data, so the sharded, which basically split data and then shows these services allocated to work after a specific data. There is a third flavor, which is the scatter-gather pattern. And again, you see, the structure is the same. There is always a user request. There is a sort of a node that processes the request, and then how the request is scattered across different nodes and then reprocessed again, so merged to get back as a response. This is similar to the sharded system in a way that a request is assigned to a specific node, but this pattern is instead of having a balancer, because we don't need a balancer in this case. We have a sort of a root node that distribute the request and then reprocess the request and the sorry, reprocess the response that it receives from the different nodes and merge that into a single client response. What's the difference with the sharded? Well, the difference is that each node works on a slice of the process that they have to elaborate. So the root node combines the various requests, split the requests in various sub-requests, assign to a single node. The node complete the request, respond with whatever output, send it back, and then the root node consolidate into one single response. Typical applications is again when you have a large amount of data that you want to split between the different nodes to run in parallel, but also when probably more recent, better reason, when you have independent processing that is needed for each request. Think about video editing. You have large data, yes, but you can elaborate in parallel different portions of video rendering for applying filters. And each node is responsible for one single responsibility, one single action. So the request comes at once. It is scattered again around all the different nodes that are specialized to work on an amount of data that is still sharded. And then the response, so the render video, is gather back into a single response and return to the client. Now, not only that, to make another, I haven't built an application for video editing. I use software already for video editing, but I have used this gather pattern in the context of searching enterprise search, so searching across a large database of documents, and say that all these documents contains the word car and the Ferrari. Now, so one way to perform this search will be to open up all the documents, read through the entire set, searching for the word in each document, and then return to the user the set of documents that contain both words. Now, as you may imagine, this is quite a slow process because it requires opening and reading through a large number of files for each request. So to make the process faster, typically you build an index. The index is a sort of a hash table where the keys are the individual words, no, car, Ferrari, and the values are a list of documents containing that word. So now, instead of searching through every document, not finding the documents that match any keyword is just as easy as looking up into this hash table. However, we have lost one important ability here. Now remember, we were looking for all the documents that contain car and Ferrari. Now, since the index only has a single words and not conjunctional words, we still need to find the documents that contain both words. Now, luckily, this is just an intersection of the set of documents returned for each word. So, given this approach, what I did, I implemented a document search using this scatter gather pattern. When a request comes into a document, sorry, when a search for a document comes into the search engine, it parses the request for the keywords and then scatter the search for each word to each service, one for the word car and one for the word Ferrari. Now, each of these services returns a list of documents that match one of the words, and the root node just consolidate this, taking the intersection of them and returning the intersection, so the combination of documents processed by node one for the keyword car, and the documents processed by node two for the keyword Ferrari, and disregard those that don't match. So think how, a way of optimizing processes when you have a parallel request and then you need the intersection, so the combination to return back to you as a response. This is the typical pattern. All right, that's it pretty much. We are at the end. Thank you very much.